A truss is a structure composed of straight members joined together at their endpoints. They are most commonly used in bridges, roofs, and towers. They look like a web of triangles joined together to evenly distribute the weight or external loads by withstanding tension or compression without bending or shearing. It's important to understand some of the assumptions that we'll use to solve all truss-related problems. All of the joints within a truss can be represented by a pin connection. This means that the straight members are free to rotate and no reaction moment is created at the connections. In the real world, you'll often see these members connected by gusset plates, the component that was used in a previous example video, link below. When the lines of all members intersect at the same point, assuming it behaves like a pin connection is reasonable. Since there is not a reaction moment at the joint, the second assumption is that trusses are made entirely of two force members. If the forces were not axial, then a moment would be created and the member would be accelerating angularly. Two force members mean that the members can only carry axial loads. We've seen this before from all the previous examples and lecture videos, but since the members are static, then the forces at each end are of equal magnitude and opposite in direction. We'll keep using the convention of positive for tension and negative for compression. Loads are only applied at the joint. We will never have loads applied in the middle of a member. This is a direct consequence of our first two assumptions. Since all joints are pinned, the members cannot carry bending moments, which should exist if a force was located somewhere between the joints. For calculation purposes, and because it's reasonable to assume that the external loads will be significantly higher than the weight of the truss itself, we'll often assume that the weight of the members is negligible. Of course, the goal of analyzing trusses is finding out the internal force of each one of the members so that we can identify that the loads are in fact roughly evenly distributing the external loads and identify if a truss is carrying a higher load that it can withstand. Of course, in those cases, we are talking about stresses, something you'll learn much more about in a later course like Mechanics of Materials. Links to that course are in the description of this video. There are two methods for solving trusses, the method of joints and the method of sections. The method of joints consists on drawing a free body diagram of each joint and writing the corresponding equilibrium equations. Since we already established that there are no reaction moments at the pins, all you have to do is write the sum of forces in the x and the y axes, three sum of forces if you're solving 3D problems, of course, and know that the pins, part of the trusses, are not moving. Just like I've suggested in all previous lectures and examples, and this is very important, any unknown force should be drawn as a force vector in tension. If a member is subjected to tension, it means that the forces are trying to stretch the member. The action-reaction nature of the forces at the joint would mean that tensile forces are drawn pointing away from the joint. If the value we solve for is indeed positive, then the force is tensile, and if the value we obtain for a force is negative, it means that the force is facing the opposite direction and is therefore negative. This way, we follow the general convention mentioned earlier and used everywhere in engineering applications of positive for tension and negative for compression. I have explained the correct use of subscripts before in a previous video, so I'll leave the link in this video's description as subscripts link with an exclamation mark, so that you can check that if you haven't already. Now, I mentioned that this method consists on writing the equilibrium equations of each joint to solve for all internal forces. Usually, you begin with where you have the most information. So for this example truss, where the only known force is the external load of 130 pounds located at point A, we would begin there at point A. FAB and FAC would be assumed to be in tension, just like every single other force like I just mentioned, and the sum of forces in the y direction would allow us to solve for FAC. And the sum of forces in the x direction would allow us to solve for FAB. The value for FAB is in fact positive, which means that member AB is in tension. The value for FAC is negative, which means that the vector should be pointing in the opposite direction, and therefore member AC is in compression. Of course, we don't need to redraw the free body diagram. The negative value for a vector in the outward direction already conveys this information. At joint B, and once again assuming positive vectors for all unknown forces, a sum of forces in X shows that FBD is positive 2, and a sum of forces in Y shows that FBC is 0. We'll get to this in just a second. Notice that, as previously mentioned, FAB and FBA have the same magnitude. There's no need to add an extra negative sign because the direction of the vectors itself already has the orientation information. At joint C, we can find FCD and FCE. CD is in tension and CE in compression. Notice that as we progress through our calculations, we're using the values of the variables we've found so far. For example, FCA, FCB, and FCD. Also, notice that we still draw FCA in tension because if one thing is essential in statics calculations, it's consistency. Finally, notice that the value we substitute for FCA is still negative from what we found before. Following the same process and making sure that we are consistent with the advice I pointed out, joint D allows to find FDE and FDF. And finally, a sum of forces in X at joint E reveals the value for FEF. With the values for all the internal forces, we see which members are under tension, which ones are under compression, and which ones have a zero force. There are two concepts to note here. First, notice that at no point we used information about the reaction forces at E or F. This is not always the case. In some cases, we will not be able to start solving for the unknown internal forces with the given information about the external loads, and therefore, in those cases, the first step will be to draw a free body diagram of the entire structure to solve for reaction forces. And then, we will most likely begin our method of joints at a joint where a reaction force occurs to start solving for internal forces. However, and this will save you a lot of time, so pay close attention, the first thing you should try to identify when solving a truss problem is if you need those reaction forces, or if you can just use the given information to solve for all internal forces, like we did with this example. The second concept is that of zero force members. I briefly just mentioned we would discuss the fact that FBC is equal to zero. In some cases, identifying zero force members can be helpful to identify members that are not withstanding forces in any way, and are therefore redundant. In those cases, identifying them serves as a way to removing them completely from our truss. However, in most cases, these zero force members are still there for a reason. It can be something as straightforward as providing extra support that comes from the fact that members under compression can buckle, which means that the members themselves are effectively bending, so to prevent that bending, a zero force member is added. If you'd like to learn more about buckling, I'll leave a link to a Mechanics of Materials lecture below. In other cases, the zero force member is there to prevent a change in loads. Since all external loads are applied to the joints, it might happen that because of the operation of the truss, think of a bridge or some other structure where the loads can change over time, an external load is applied to the joint where the zero force members is connected to, and the member would no longer be subjected to an internal force of zero. The second method we'll use is the method of sections. This method is usually used when we're not interested in finding all the internal forces, but only some of them. However, it can be used in combination with the method of joints to solve for all internal forces as well. Just like with the method of joints, we'll sometimes need to start by drawing a free body diagram of the entire structure to find reaction forces. But sometimes, the external loads will suffice, so make sure to be able to identify that before you begin your calculations, otherwise you'll be spending unnecessary time finding unnecessary reaction forces. And I'll help you with that with the example we'll use today. The method consists of cutting the structure and drawing the internal forces, and you guessed it right, always assuming positive tension vectors. The external and internal forces at the cut should be in equilibrium. The cut can be performed anywhere you want, but keep in mind that the more internal forces you obtain after performing the cut, the more variables you'll have. So try not to make a cut that will yield 4 or more unknowns. 3 is usually a good number, and the way to proceed after making the cut is to write a sum of moments about a point, in this case a joint, where 2 of the unknown internal forces are pointing towards. That way, only one unknown will be present in that equation, and you can therefore easily solve for it. Let's look at an example where we can more clearly see these three ideas we pointed out. We want to find the internal forces of members DC, HC, and HI, stating if they are in tension or compression. Since we don't need to find internal forces for other members, and these three member forces will be exposed with only one cut, the method of sections makes sense here. Notice that regardless of the section we keep, we'll need either the reaction forces at F or the reaction forces at A. This means that the first step is indeed drawing a free body diagram of the entire structure and writing the equilibrium equations to find the reaction forces. If we're gonna use the bottom right section during our method of sections later, the only reaction forces we'll need are those at A, which can be found by writing the sum of moments about A to find the reaction force at F, and the sum of forces in X and Y to find AX and AY respectively. With the reaction forces in X and Y at joint A, we draw the free body diagram of the section with the three internal forces we're looking for, and write the equilibrium equations. Since both CD and CH pass through joint C, a sum of moments about C should be the first equation, as it will allow us to solve for FIH right away. Similarly, the line of action of internal forces DC and HI pass through D. So a sum of moments about D will only have FCH as a variable, and we can solve for it. Finally, we can use either the sum of forces in X or Y to find the third and last variable, FDC. Notice once again that I used CD or DC interchangeably, as well as CH and HC or IH and HI, because the magnitude of the vectors is the same. Yet another advantage of being consistent. The signs of these forces show us that members IH and CH are under tension and member CD is under compression. Each truss will have a slightly different process, so like I mentioned before, sometimes you don't even need to find the reaction forces of the entire truss. But sometimes you do. Sometimes only one sum of moments is necessary, but sometimes writing two sum of moments makes solving for our variables a bit easier and quicker, like in this example today. To check some other examples where we use the method of joints and the method of members, make sure to check out the links in the description below. There, you will find the links to the other main lecture videos from the statics course. Thanks for watching!